when you become personal, then the mind activity becomes virile. Can you remain empty, neutral, detached, you see? And you must carry this exercise on for half an hour. Very good to see you. Wonderful. I feel there's a raging fire, Kim. And it really, from time to time, it comes up like that. And I feel it's time now for Sangha to make another leap. And not another of many more kind of leaps. I feel that there's something quite powerful and very immediate, very potent for those who accept this invitation, actually. I see no reason why anyone should not accept it. So those of you who have begun to take this invitation on will quickly see. And if I can put it in very simple terms, it's asking you to sit by yourself and begin. For many people, I say you go sit under a tree, sit wherever you feel comfortable for a while, and for half an hour, at least each day. I didn't tell them that to start with. I said, let's do this exercise first. After the exercise was grasped, I said, then, will you do this for half an hour each day? And we will do this for a week. And what is the exercise? It is that you sit and the mind will come. The usual things, which seem very normal. It's been so normalized, the activity of mind, in terms of its relationship or the relationship of ourself in identity with the mind, seems like it's a whole relationship goes on, very normalized. And with this identity of personhood, maybe you may say, if I say a sattvic sense of personhood, would you understand this term? Meaning that, you know, the higher stage of identity, sattvic meaning more pure. Why I make this distinction is because the person is still a sort of separate sense, a separate autonomy, an identity, personal identity. You may hear me use sometimes the word ego. I find them very synonymous, actually. Because normally when we say ego, we think it's a behavior. Ego is not necessarily or restricted to only behavior. It means where there is a very rooted identity based upon I am this body, and I am effective, we don't say it, but effective, I'm my conditioning, who I take myself to be. My experiences, history, all of that contribute to the self I function as daily, naturally, normally. But here when I ask, could you sit and try to be just by yourself, with let the mind run, let things, don't try to police your thinking, just let it run. And I say, can you observe without logging into that which is observable, meaning that there is some detached witnessing, just of the stuff that arises. And when I say this, I want to clarify even further that it's not about watching like you watch a movie. You're paying attention. You're not following a story. But I'm more like a panoramic overview of what's coming up in mind as thought and sensations. And now I say, but remain detached. I mean, don't log into the mind wave. To remain conscious and apart from the activity that's coming up. Sensationally, psychically, physically, emotionally, all these things may come in one form or another. And that play is going on the screen of the mind. So, but only to pay attention to your formless or impersonal sense of presence or being. Is that clear enough? That is the important part, to stay only as the awareness self. So not a form, not a shape, not an identity, not the guy on your passport or the woman on the passport, just the sense of presence. Here, the witnessing is happening spontaneously. And try not to get pulled into the mind. It seems, it's going to be a pleasant little exercise. But it's going to be quite a mugging, actually. And we start like that, and you see how easy it is to follow, to be pulled into. I say that the mind comes in this way, and each time it's like it comes for some food. It needs to be fed. And what is the food of this mind activity? To connect with personal identity. When you become personal, then the mind activity becomes virile. Then the show begins like that. But I've asked you not to log in. Don't put in your password. Simply just observe with detachment and keep your sense of presence. Impersonal presence. We're observing of the mind activity in the world is happening. And just pay attention. Don't hide. Don't close your eyes. Even if closed eyes, mind is still going to go on. So whatever is happening in the outer sense of the mind and life, and what is happening also behind the eyeballs in the realm of thought and feeling, sensation, let them happen. Can you remain empty, neutral, detached, you see? And you must carry this exercise on for half an hour. And it doesn't matter, because you, first of all, accept you're going to have in the beginning, a lot of sense of failing. Then as you begin to recognize how virile the mind activity is, when you have been cooperating with it, it feels normal. But now I'm just trying to show, can you simply be without engaging in identity and mind activity? And you see how easy the attention goes like this. Yeah? And after a while, you'll realize, wait a second, it's as though I'm choiceless. I'm not able to stay by myself. My attention is always engaged in what is next, or the next taste, the next sensation. And this is not new. Perhaps all our life we have lived like that. But it's become normalized because nobody questions it. But now we're questioning it. Not questioning it verbally, just asking this simple exercise to stabilize your attention just in presence. Be aware of the mind. And you start itching a little bit, you know, something is going to feel like the longest half an hour you've spent consciously. Because you see somehow, again, some little thing, need not be anything spectacular or so important, how easily we are pulled into identity, pulled into the active action, reaction, interaction with that. So this is what I've asked. And how will your first half an hour session be? You see? Then you realize, wait a second, this is how I've been living. This has been my life. Simply cooperating with the mind pull, the reflex, to always just be in some mental state. You see? And then what I'm getting feedback from many people is, I can't live like this anymore. I am a prisoner in my own life. Actually, you are not a prisoner. Your identity as a person is the prisoner. And because it has been unquestioned, it becomes what represents you is personal identity. And that is the relationship, the dynamic relationship with the mind stuff and the person for whom it seems applicable and relevant. Now watched from increasingly, you'll come to see that there is a deeper space of witnessing that is untouched. It has no identity. It is pure consciousness itself. And it is always here. The fact that you are aware that you exist is because of this root consciousness. But from the consciousness takes the form of the person by accepting I am the body, which is the instrument through which consciousness can enjoy or taste experiencing. And the belief, okay, I am the one, I want, I don't want, I like, this is not good, this is bad, I am this, I am. All of these are mental formations. They have no reality by themselves. This is why you may have heard me say there's one earth, but there are billions of worlds, each world being a psychological subjective interpretation of what we see. The physical world is in a sense, it is what it is. But the relationship created through the mind and identity makes it unique, uniquely your own experience personally. We are not going to fight with that. We are not trying to get rid of a world. We are not going to judge, condemn, only observe. So I'm introducing only the power of observing. And so this is what I'm asking. Can you bear your non-dual observing? Remain detached and just be aware of what comes. So, as I said in the beginning, many people report, every little thing you feel, okay, sorry, wait a second, I've got to go and make a coffee. I've got to, feed the cat. Every kind of avoidance is going to come and it's going to seem justifiable. And then sitting, remember, this is your choice. It's not a command. I'm asking, are you willing to commit to looking? And why should you not? It's going to be the most powerful exercise, the most relevant, the most revealing, the most empowering. And are you on board for it? This is what I'm asking. Because what I found is that there are many people, we have the impression we are doing quite well. You know? We're doing quite well. We're doing the inquiry. We're reading. We're, sitting in meditation. We're chanting. All these things. But this you have not done to actually be tested. So first you test yourself, you sit. I will not have to tell you how powerful and important this exercise will be. I want you to tell me if you are willing to take it on. Above all practices and exercises, this until now will be the most direct. And it will be something that you must have a sense of commitment, a sense of responsibility that this is only for you. You cannot do it for someone else. This is only for you. And to learn to observe. And don't worry about the sense of failure. Give room. It's going to happen. The sense of, forget about the actions, reactions to it also. Just each time, come back. Don't waste time complaining and feeling, why can't I do it? Just come back and again stay. And gradually the force of presence will begin to come through. The claustrophobia of that mental noise that you will experience, if you persist, will begin to ease away from you. You begin to feel your true being again, not separate from you, not you feeling your being, You are the being. You become naturally more stable, more calm, and that conviction ought to grow, that determination, I have to keep this up. I have to do this. Because Babaji said, no, because I see the fire it creates in my life. And yet, even in its most turbulent stages, you sense already the power of self-discovering in a very direct way. So I'm very, very pleased for those who feel, I'm taking this challenge. And you're going to see whether you, once you recognize the force of the mind tsunamis that will come, and you realize that it is not what you are. This is very important, that there is a space that is untouched by it, and there's a space that seems very, very touched and disturbed by it. And the space that is touched and disturbed by it is your regular living space as a person. Are you willing to feel that challenge and know that somehow it is possible going beyond it and stay with it? Once you have you're in the flow of this discovery, it will become more compelling for most people. Some may give up and say, well, I'm out of here, I can't take this onslaught. My mind is too strong. I can't imagine, if you realize how strong the mind, the psychological mind and identity has become, whether you'd want to just kind of say, you know what, okay, I still go along and cooperate with it, because at least it seems more simple. And I know that world. I'm very familiar with being that person. And so I don't want to be disturbed any further. I want to see if there's someone like this, or that you're able to take this beautiful, auspicious challenge, that I don't feel that you can fail. If there's a sense of failure, it is from the person. It's because of identity. And holding on, clinging to the identity of personhood. Because through this exercise, you'll realize the shallowness of personal identity and ego. But at the same time, you will not be left out at sea. You will, at the same time, simultaneously become aware of the greater space, limitless space, of your true being. Okay? So, this is not an advertisement, okay? It's just to share with you what we are focusing on. Because I've known people, some people for many years, they've been in some kind of practice, practicing here, listening to invitation, but because the person is doing it, after a while, we start to plateau off. The mind feels, listen, I think I've done enough. I think I'm okay now. But with this this exercise I'm offering, I don't know. I'll have to see if it comes to the same point where someone feels, you know, actually, I think I've transcended the mind thing, and I'll settle for a nice handshake with the mind, and we strike a deal or what. I'm very keen to see how we go, you see. So I'm just sharing this. And I would like also that the whole Sangha, that I would imagine that it would be a reflex to say, yes, I have to, you know, to keep expanding in this invitation to self-discovery. It's good? Very good.
I want to say I have started to sit. I've started with 20 minutes.
Yes.
And it's like an octopus and its tentacles. And I'm seeing the octopus's tentacles, and it's pulling here and it's pulling there. Mm. and it's coming back again.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, I didn't realize how much stuff there is until you really try and sit quietly and
yes,
and avoid it and get past it. And
yes,
even the littlest of what we would call stupid thing,
yes,
just wants to just, you know, pick.
Yes, yes, yes. And, you know, when you see that there's perceiving of this, remember that at first it is the mind person that's going to seek to be taking credit for the seeing. But the mind create itself is very much a part of this disturbing or this, you know, this very dynamic play. Of course, there's room for mind, there's room for everything. But right now, I say, now come back to this place. Because once you can have a measure of the strength of the pulsation of distractedness, and that you know, actually, those who have transcended, who are awake, have gone through the same thing. And now, in our time, this is very direct. Yeah. It's very direct, very immediate.
And a beautiful feeling to get to that peace.
Yes.
When you're looking at all these things and the mind's coming at you and then you get back to that peace, it's, you just don't want to leave it.
Yes.
It's yourself. It's just...
Yes. At first, you are going to feel that, you know, wow, I cannot, oh, it's too hard for me. And still, this is still what I call the sattvic self, the sattvic person, the one who is in the role of the seeker right now, the one on the journey of self-discovery, is still half-half, someplace in the phenomenal identity mixed with consciousness, is acting as the seeker. So when you feel the pull of identity and the crowd that comes up in the mind, it's as though you put your foot in an ant nest and all of this is going. And the one that feels under pressure is your person. It is not the beingness. The beingness provides the light and the power. It is the authority. But it is not the one busy trying to put out fires. First, you include, remember I've been saying recently, that all the pain and the suffering and the sufferer are like two sides of one coin. Why I said like this? The self is not a coin. So when I say the feeling at first is that this is really difficult, it's very hard to keep focus, it's a mixture coming from person and presence is giving this feedback. But at the same time, there's this inner quality like a deep promise, a kind of a growing certitude in you. I'm crossing over. I gave example, like if you had a big stone that you had to turn over on its back. The first part to get it up to that point is feel like a lot of work just to get it. And once it reaches a certain place, it tilts over, then it becomes easier. So it's going to feel as though you are lifting up something. Just staying put and try to witness without becoming involved. Gradually, don't zoom in on any particular activity of the mind. More zoom out and take more of a kind of panoramic field. Sometimes, naturally, a focus is going to go towards something. Wherever the focus goes, it is always personal. And you'll feel the heat of that is there. And you'll hear me telling you, okay, just let that run. It doesn't need your help. Just observe. And don't get involved in it. More, be very conscious to be one with just that neutral witnessing. And so in the early stages, the force of distractedness will come. you start to feel itchy and things to do, and I need to make this phone call, and I come back and sit again. Let's have a cup of tea. Oh no, I've taken sugar. No, not with Nick. Mm-hmm. And you see, and somehow it's going to dawn. What am I doing? Who is doing all this stuff? Who has to make all these decisions? Mr. Guy. And you, something again, come back. Stop feeling, oh, why is this happening? Don't lament. No time for lamenting. Just come back again. Keep looking. And gradually the force to remain neutral or empty, not by covering your eyes or blurring the senses, but just being very sober, but hold on to the beingness. It is there anyway. The beingness never went away. It's just because of this distractedness that then went into the shape of person, and then the person create the world with the mind. And you're simply watching this. So we don't have to give up something, give up your job, give up family, nothing like this. It's not necessary. Just you come back to yourself, and your world will come into focus in a natural way. Okay? So I feel that this is the best way I could have spent this short time to share this. And thank you for your attention on it. Very good. Very good. And bless each one for this stage in our self-awareness, self-realization, like this. Many things will seem to come as though to put you off coming into such clarity. It will feel like that, like the mind has an intelligence of its own to sabotage this this recognition. But don't worry, the only real thing here is the consciousness. And abide in that as that itself.